Hi folks, welcome back to the Astroform channel. So today I wanted to share with you a video about capturing and post-processing an object, in this case the Lagoon Nebula. For those of you who do not know, the Lagoon Nebula is a very beautiful interstellar cloud. It's an emission nebula in the constellation Sagittarius. So from my position in the Netherlands at 52 degrees latitude, it is actually due south during summertime, close to the horizon. Yeah, I just wanted to share with you my attempt to capture this object. What is that exactly? So I will share with you a video I took during capturing time, and I will talk to you about the challenges I was facing to capture this object. I was a little bit rattled in that video because I was worried that the images would not come out so great, but in the end I think I have a pretty decent picture of the Lagoon Nebula. I'm happy to share that with you, and also I will talk to you about the post-processing part, so the steps I took in stacking the images. I used Deep Sky Stacker for that, and also what kind of actions I took to further post-process the images in Photoshop and Lightroom in my case, because that's the material or the software I'm working with. And that's it. If you have any comments or questions, please do not hesitate to put your comments down below in the comment section. I'm always happy to learn from you on how to improve my astrophotography skills. Maybe I can help you with some issues or things you want to resolve for your own astrophotography, to improve your own astrophotography experience. Always happy to help, and even if you have some ideas on how to improve my videos, I'm just an amateur guy making these videos. So if you have any idea on how to improve that as well, you are most welcome to comment down below. Thanks for watching, and hope you have you find this video useful. See you later, bye bye. First of all, it's summertime, so I'm limited to about 4 or 5 hours of capturing time from the Netherlands, because we have long nights, we have short nights and long days. Second of all, the Lagoon Nebula is pretty close to the horizon, so that means that the first hour or 2 hours they will be gone, because the Lagoon Nebula is behind that building. And then when it finally becomes visible, it is visible exactly above the city center in the south, close to the horizon, so I'm working with heavy light pollution. I only have about 2 hours to capture it before it disappears below the horizon again. And another challenge is, it is because it is so close to the horizon, I realized objects close to the horizon, they move relatively quickly as compared to objects that are close to the zenith, close to, for instance, Polaris. And my AVX mount actually has some trouble on accurately tracking the Lagoon Nebula that is so close to the horizon and moving so fast. So I think I'm limited to about 2 minutes of capturing time for each of the pictures I can get. What I'm trying to do to combat all of these challenges is like limit my shutter time to 2 minutes. Second of all, I'm using narrowband filters to cancel out all of the light pollution from the city center. So H-alpha S2O3 filters from ZWO. I'm using an 80mm APO refractor and my ASI 1600 mono camera, cooled. So yeah, hope you like it. If you have any comments, don't hesitate to share them with me. And always glad to share my experiences. So thanks for watching, and I hope you learned something, and see you later.
So, hi folks, I just wanted to go through the process of Deep Sky Stacker. I always use Deep Sky Stacker to stack my frames because it's free. And just to give you a quick overview. So I have used three separate narrowband filters, the H-alpha, the S2 and the O3 filters. And I ended up with about 30 frames for each frame has an exposure time of 2 minutes. So for each of the filters, I have about 30 frames with a 2 minute exposure. Of course, I went through all of my light frames and checked whether or not there were any issues with star trailing or planes going through the image and that kind of stuff. So you leave the best ones in and you delete the ones you don't like. I'm sure you're somewhat familiar with this process, and also, of course, I have used dark frames and flat frames to compensate. So, for each of the filters, I have used 35. I thought it was 35. Yeah, here, I've used 35 flat frames to compensate the light frame, and also I had about 20 dark frames. Cooled at minus 25 degrees with an exposure time of 2 minutes. I would have liked to include more darks, but actually my library only had 20 dark frames with an exposure time of 2 minutes at minus 25, so I have to improve my library on that. And maybe a final thing. So I have here group 1 is the O2 and group 3, or group 2 is the S2, group 1 is the O2, and the main group holds all of my H-alpha pictures. And also for each of these flat frames, I have shot the flat frames through the filter I was using. So I have flat frames using my H-alpha filter, I have flat frames using my O3 filters, and I have separate flat frames for using my S2 filter. I don't know whether or not this is wise, so if you have any comments on that, I'm happy to hear your thoughts on this. And of course, what I always do is I choose one reference frame in Deep Sky Stacker. So in this case, I have used this particular frame because I liked the frame, the H-alpha picture, mainly because the target object is pretty sharp and it is situated nicely in the center of the frame. So I use that one as a reference, and this means that the Deep Sky Stacker will put all of the other pictures in a similar position as this picture. So that's it. So let's move on to Photoshop. So I stacked all of those frames. I actually ended up with three stacks for each filter. So I have here the S2 stack of 28 frames using a 2 minute exposure, as I said, and I cooled it at minus 25. So 28 frames stacked, I ended up with this image. And you can also see that the bottom is not entirely showing, so I had to do some cropping also. You see here the O3 results. So at O3, I had the center of the Lagoon Nebula, which is pretty nice, I think. Keep in mind this is only a 1 hour capturing time, so I have 30 frames of 2 minutes, so this is after 1 hour exposure. I'm happy with that already. And then I have the H-alpha stack of 30 frames, and actually you see here that because it's an emission nebula, it's an H2 region, you can really take advantage of your H-alpha filter. You can see here that it's showing the Lagoon Nebula in all its glory, basically. So that was nice. And next I will show you what I did to further calibrate these pictures. Okay, so what I always do next is to use curves and levels to further bring out the object. Without getting into too much detail, so you have here curves and levels, and what you can basically do is here you can copy your background picture into a first layer. That's what I am always doing, at least, and then in this first layer I will just using levels and curves. So for instance, levels, I always try to put that a little bit halfway on this input level. And then you can of course stretch your image using your using curves. So here I always take maybe the center of this peak, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, or 8 times I will put the curve a little bit above the line. And then this is my first curve stretch, and then I will reposition the level again. And this is really a very quick overview of what I do. I will spend much more time on doing that actually, but then I will put it up a little bit more. And then again, I'm going back to these levels and I will put that into this position again. And so you can imagine that from this first image that I've took from a deep sky stacker, I'm using these curves and levels to make the image or to make the object stand out of the image. And I've played with this, and then for the H2 stack, I came up with this picture. For the O2 stack, let's see, it's this one. Yeah, I came up with this picture. And then for the H-alpha stack, you can really see the difference. I'm going from this to this. You can see here nicely the whole nebula, and also even some faint nebula around the Lagoon Nebula even. I will just quickly go through the process of combining these three narrowband images together after the curves and the level stretches are done. So what I usually do is to, I'm copying in this, oh wait, I will start with the S2. So I will copy the S2 frame. Into a new frame. I'm using Control N to start up to get to this screen, and I want an RGB color, a new frame, a color mode frame. So I create that. I will paste first of all the S2 layer into this frame, and I will use an adjustment layer, a hue saturation adjustment layer. This is pretty important if you've never done this. And I use previous layer to create a clipping mask, and I want to create an SHO combination, as they call it. So the SHO combination basically means that the S2 filter will be used as input for red, the H alpha image will be used as input for green, and the O3 filter will be used as input for blue. And of course you can combine it in any way you want, because this is narrowband. But the SHO combination is also often used in Hubble pictures, and it gives you this nice bluish kind of O3. And the H alpha picture, which is usually the picture that has the most information, especially in emission nebula, this will be used to create a green. But this green can be altered a little bit into a beautiful goldish color. I will show you the whole process without taking too long, hopefully. So we have here the S2 first. So the S2 will be information for green. For red, I'm sorry. So the S will be used, S2 will be used for red, and I checked this colorize thing, or I checked it on. I use 0 as input for red. I want to completely saturate the picture, and then I tune down usually the lightness a little bit, and then we end up with this red. Okay, let's move on to the O3 stack. So this is the, let's first do the H alpha stack. So the H alpha stack, I will put that on top of the S2. So this is the H alpha stacked image, and again I will use layers, so new adjustment layers, use saturation. I will use this to create a clipping mask. I will colorize it, and what I'm always doing is then use this input for green, so that would be 120, saturated to 100%, and then tune back on the lightness with minus 50. And then the final image would be the O3. We copy it and we also paste it into this picture. And this is the O3 image. Hopefully this is nice. Oh, the O2. Ah, here we go. Sorry. O1, 2, 3. And then again, we use this new adjustment layer, or at least I do that. And oh, you can actually also mention that this is the color blue we are trying to create. Colorize and then put it at, better type it in, 240, 100, minus 50. So now you can still see that these images, I can see, so these are blue, these are green, supposed to be green, and these are supposed to be red. And of course the trick is now to combine these three pictures. And what you should do here is to use screening. Let's see, how did it go? So I select this image and it is it's set to normal, but if you put it to screen here and you also put your H alpha to screen here, then you can see already that you combine all of these images. And I'm trying to zoom in now. Why am I not able to zoom in? Let's see, please. Ah, here we go. Yeah, you can see already, this is nowhere this is nowhere perfect, but you can at least see that the green is mixing a little bit with the red and the blue. What is also often done is to use an H alpha frame as an extra frame to put over all of these, to put it over all of these other frames. Let's see, can I do that without... Ah, there it is. And then you can use luminosity, and then basically you want not to fill it entirely, but you can put it up a little bit. And why this is done is mostly because the H alpha frame contains most of the information. So when you use it as a luminosity overlay, basically, then you will create a little bit more detail into the image as compared to not doing that. So in this case, you can do it like this, and you can see, wow, what a beautiful picture. Not really, but anyway, you can of course then start to play around with these hue saturation levels for each of the pictures. But what I normally do is now just save the image. So save as, let's say, an HSO combination without the layers, and I save it usually as a TIFF file. Okay. And okay, this is now, I'm going a little bit off track from what I wanted to tell you, but okay, now I have saved it hopefully in the right, here we have the SHO combi, so I open it up again as a single picture. So now it's only, it doesn't have the layered information, it only has this combined information, just one RGB color. And then, to make things a little bit easier, you can use the, where is it, the Deep Sky Colors filter, and this is the Hasta La Vista Green. So for those of you who speak English or speak Spanish, sorry, Hasta La Vista betekent goodbye, and green actually means green, so goodbye green. And you, I will just show you, you can do it a strong, medium or weak kind of makeover. So let's take the weak of the medium. And you see now that already you have now this nicer image of, brownish, goldenish, Lagoon Nebula with this nice blue interior. section. Sorry for this English, it's not very well, but I'm trying to do my best here. But at least so you can see that, I showed you a little bit. You have first these curves and these levels in Photoshop, then you combine it adjustment layers, putting that all together using screening. Maybe you want to put an H alpha luminosity layer on top of it to maybe increase the signal of the image a little bit. Then I saved it off as just a TIFF file without any of the layer information. And I use this filter, Deep Sky Colors, Hasta La Vista Green. You can actually download it. You can Google it. So you have, let's see. Oh, I have to do something with my screen because otherwise you cannot see what I'm doing. Here. So almost done. Yeah, I hope you can see now. So we have Hasta La Vista Green filter, and actually you can just here you can see it. It's great stuff, of course. Somebody else made it. Hasta La Vista Green posted in 2010 already. and actually you can download it here somewhere, so here. And go through all of the steps. I will not explain them now, but you can download this and put it as a filter in Photoshop, and you end up with this. And now, of course, I did a little bit of tweaking and back and forward, and I will not get into that right now, but I will show you the end result. So in the end, I ended up with this this picture. And I'm really happy with it because you can of course you can clearly see now the Lagoon Nebula. I took some extra steps like cranked up the clarity, and I looked a little bit at the edges and I tried to soften the edges a little bit. I was somewhat successful, but not perfectly successful. And I'm happy with this end result because. I know I have only 3 hours of information, I can clearly see the Lagoon Nebula, the Messier 8 object, and I'm actually happy with this. Maybe I can do a lot more to further improve this image. I hope you have gotten a glimpse of all the steps I have taken from stacking the pictures, doing some curves and level stretches, what I did to combine all of the narrowband stacks into one, and I used the Hasta La Vista Green filter to adjust the coloring basically of the image. And then I fine-tuned it to get to this end result. I'm talking too much. I hope you like this video. I hope you like this kind of information. Maybe you want to know something more. If you want to learn something or ask me something, please do not hesitate to comment on this video. I try to respond to your questions. Also, if you have any idea on how to improve my imaging skills or on how to improve my videos, leave a comment down below. I will respond to the comments you have. And I hope you learned something, and I hope this information was useful to you. With that, we're at the end of the video. And so thank you for watching, and see you in the next video.